Okay, so we'll move on to our next part of the agenda, and now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of Myeloma 101. And it's really my privilege and honor to welcome my partner and dear friend and colleague, Dr. Nikhil Munshi, who's a professor of medicine and an international leader in the area of diagnosis, prognosis, and risk, and genetics. So with that, and no more ado, Nikhil, please, thank you.
Thank you so much, Paul, and welcome on this nice and cold day. Good to be inside, and what a story. And every time we hear, there's different inspiration about what patients can do for us and for each other. And a very enlightening story in some ways, reflecting what you could do. It's in late 90s. When we didn't have any of these new drugs, no thalidomide, no lenalidomide, no bortezomib, transplant was the mainstay of the treatment. And one of the centers, big center in myeloma besides us here, was in Arkansas. And a patient comes there who had all the treatments, the treatments had failed. Sort of running out of options. Today we don't run out of options. We have unbelievable number of options we can go to. But then there was a time when you would run out of options. And patient's wife came with a name of a drug that she had researched, talking to Dr. Folkman here in late 90s, and said, if you don't have many options, do you think this drug can work for my husband? And so because of the ongoing research here, Ken was working on and we were working on there, it looked like that drug could be tried. And what is there to lose? And so we said, yeah, we could try that. And the wife was very prepared. So she pulled out a phone number of the doctor in a company that made that drug and said, maybe that's a person you should call if you are ready to get the drug. So the phone was made, and while getting drug for that patient, we said, there's another similar patient who may benefit too, so maybe give us drug for two patients. And so both got the drug. The drug was thalidomide. And the first patient had some response, not super. The second patient actually went into complete remission. And knowing the state the patient was, that was real, that this is a real drug. And then that point onwards, a bigger study was done. Ken here studied how the drug works, and that has brought us to today. Well, like I said, we don't run out of options. We may not be able to get rid of the disease, but it's becoming something like diabetes. You can't cure it, but you can treat it and take insulin every day and go on with your life. And so that's the progress, and some of the roots of it was how patients were proactive, and so we like that. We don't mind your asking questions, and that's so very important. So again, thank you, Jim, and thanks all of you for helping us do what we do. So what I'm going to talk about is a more simpler thing. You're going to hear a lot of new things in treatment for the disease and treatment of complication and how to prevent it. What I'm going to talk about is how do we diagnose myeloma and sort of can we select patients for treatment and what is new in this disease? As we understand the disease and the genomics, which you will hear a lot here and outside, how does it help? And there has been tremendous progress in that. So as you know, myeloma is changing in some ways. As we used to see, and I think most of us are now doing this for more than 25 years, in this room, that also tells a lot about us and our age. But it has changed. We used to see patients who had more advanced disease, more symptoms. The advanced disease doesn't matter as much, and quite often we are asked, what's my stage? My doctor hasn't told me the stage, and we don't discuss much because the new drugs work very well, irrespective of the stage. But patients have less problems. You can see, bone pain, for example. It used to be two-thirds of the patient had bone pain. Now that's not so common. And that's good because the quality of life is better. And what matters today, as you will hear, is not treating myeloma and controlling it and extending life. That we do it and do it very successfully. Now it's important to maintain the good quality of life. And having less complications to start with gives us a chance to maintain that. For example, kidney problem, only in 10% of patients compared to what it used to be, 30% of the patient. So the disease is changing in a way that allows us to keep you healthy and better or more functional for a long period of time. Now, diagnosis of myeloma was made in late 50s when the right tools were available. So we look for protein in blood, we do the bone marrow, and look for this kind of myeloma cells, and then do all different imaging to look for these bone lesions and other changes in blood. What has happened now is that we do many more tests so that we can understand the disease better and we can follow it. So we now do this assay that some of you may know very well, free light chain assay, which we do it in everybody. And the reason to mention this is because this is how we follow your disease, and quite often this is how you will follow your disease. So for you to understand what numbers, what are these numbers, what does it mean, and how do I look at it? We do this kind of genetic genomic analysis, quite routinely done at our center, to look for how your myeloma may behave, called FISH analysis. And we do the MRI or PET CT scan to look for different bone lesions. When we did the old-fashioned x-rays, wasn't sensitive enough. And then a lot of new advances in genomics that informs us about the disease. So just to give an example of what are these numbers that we look at and that you should look at. So when you have a diagnosis of myeloma, your physician or us here, if you are coming primarily here, we would say you have IgG myeloma. So what does this mean? It means that your myeloma is making a protein, which is called IgG. We measure it, so you can look at all the IgG numbers. You could have IgA myeloma, and you can follow IgA numbers. But the level of that number, the level of the protein, reflects how much myeloma cells you have in the body. So it sort of indirectly tells us, unlike in lung cancer, we take an x-ray and say you have 2 centimeter mass, for us, that measurement is the IgG protein. They quite often match closely. So we look at IgG level. We do this serum protein electrophoresis. And this is where you would hear about M protein. So M protein, for our practical purpose, stands for myeloma protein. It's the protein that is only made by myeloma cell, and that's another way to measure how much myeloma you have. And then we do the 24-hour urine protein electrophoresis. And it's not a difficult test, but I find that that's the one test that most of the patients complain the most about. It's not easy. It's used to be easier in the past when you can carry your jug from home and bring it here. Now I don't think you can carry in the plane. Jug full of fluid in the plane is not allowed. From the carrying milk for the baby, the criteria the TSA is using is whatever you're carrying, you should be able to test it to be allowed on the plane. And I don't think that's feasible. So we do the 24-hour protein, not as much as we used to, because we have this serum free light chain assay that has helped us do it less frequently. But there are patients who make or who secrete the protein in urine, and we have to do those tests almost every monthly if that's the only way we can measure myeloma. Then we do bone marrow, the dreaded bone marrow, 38 bone marrows, right? He is a trooper. But that's very helpful. So myeloma cells remain in the bone marrow. That's where it normally is present. When it becomes cancerous, that's where it still remains most of the time. So like doing a lung biopsy or a breast biopsy, this is what we do to know where the disease is and how much it is. So it's very helpful to do that sometimes. Also to look for other changes. As Jim had leukemia, we can sometimes do bone marrow and find are there any changes that is leading that way if there are some indications. So it's very helpful for us to do it on certain occasion. It's not necessary to do it every month or every year, but at certain specific time point, depending upon how your disease is. What it is also helping us, and for which we are so thankful, is to do some of our research. Most of you, when you come here, one of us would have asked, would you mind if we use our extra bone marrow? We're not going to do specially bone marrow. Can we use your extra bone marrow for research? And it has helped us so much, as you will see, all the studies we have done, looking for genes which are changing, that are mutated. How can we make personalized treatment? We have been able to do it because of your generosity in letting us use this. Number of you say, well, if you have to do extra marrow, please do it. But that's what helps us. What we do in a regular course is to look at, when we do bone marrow at the diagnosis or subsequently, we look at cells like this, and we characterize it with an analysis like this, where we know these are your myeloma cells which are making kappa light chain protein or IgA protein to confirm that these are the abnormal cells. And between these two tests, the blood and urine and bone marrow, we know that you have a disease that may be related with myeloma. It doesn't automatically become myeloma, because myeloma should have had some other impact on your body for us to treat it, and I'll come to that in a minute. So one more word about this light chain assay that we do. There was time in old days, which was not more than a few years ago, when we didn't have this test, and that's when number of myelomas were considered non-secretory myeloma. We cannot measure the protein and judge how much myeloma you have. We had to use some alternative, not so accurate method. Since this test has become available now around 7 or 8 years ago, for the last 7 or 8 years, the myeloma which used to be called non-secretory with 0% protein, now 80% of those patients have the protein. So we can just do a simple blood test and follow our treatment. And that's made everybody's, our and your life, easier. So this is a very important test. It also helps us that some of the patients have smoldering myeloma, or some have MGUS, MGUS. Are there patients in the room with smoldering myeloma or MGUS? There are a number of you, right. So this is a stage of the disease, as I will show in a minute, where generally, on a regular basis, we don't need to treat. We wait. But then we have identified features that might tell us who may have a little higher chance of progressing to myeloma. And that helps us in two ways. One is it helps us decide how often we should see you. Can I see you just once a year? Or should I see you every 2 months so that we can follow it closely? And one of the features is this free light chain assay. So if patients have all the three features not in the right direction in patients with MGUS, they may have 60% chance in 20 years, long time, very slowly, but reasonable chance that it can become myeloma. None of those features are present, only 5% chance in 20 years, almost baseline. I can see you every year or 2 years, or sometimes your primary can follow. Same way in smoldering myeloma, if these three different features are present, the chance of developing myeloma is higher. If only one is present, it's lower. But patients who have higher chance of developing myeloma are the groups of patients where we are doing research to see, can we prevent your smoldering myeloma from becoming myeloma? Because that's a really cancer prevention strategy. And that's very important, because those who have smoldering myeloma, they feel there's a time bomb ticking and you don't want to do anything about. They're very uncomfortable with that notion. We don't do it for the right purpose except for the research, and that's what I would encourage you to take part in it. There are a lot of other approaches being used for that prevention, from utilizing some of the myeloma drugs to giving vaccination, so some other immune manipulation or modification. So there are ways to prevent it. But we use these kind of features to decide who should be put on this study. So we do the serum free light chain very routinely. Every time you get a blood test here, we do this test. So if you are into computers and Excel file, you can have a table of serum free light chain. Where is it going? The important point of following this is that it may be good to follow these numbers, but it's interpretation. We have patients whose numbers are within the normal range. Serum free light chain is 30. Normal is from 10 to 20. And now 13 has become 14 next month, and they would call us saying, wow, my numbers are going up. And that's not what we want. We don't want you to be too much on the edge with some of this. It's good to ask, but not to be worried about looking at this number. So follow the numbers, but do not be excessively concerned with the changes. Let us help you, or when you come here, explain to you what it means. Because some of these changes are of no consequence. It doesn't mean your myeloma is growing. All of us, with or without myeloma, have this fluctuation. If I take your blood today and put it in two different tubes and send to the lab, I'll get two different numbers, just because the tests have differing numbers. If I take blood today and tomorrow without any treatment, the numbers might be different. So there are fluctuations which are normal and does not mean your myeloma is growing or changing. So how do we diagnose myeloma versus what we call early disease? Basically based on the fact that does myeloma or the protein has impacted your body, what we call end organ effects. So if the calcium is high, if kidney functions are not good, patients have anemia or bone lesions. And in that regards, we do the blood test and see if you have anemia or not. We do blood chemistry, creatinine and calcium, and then we do look for bone disease by doing various imaging, which I will show in a minute. So every time you come, you might end up with five tubes of blood taken for examination, and some patients think that this is how we cure myeloma, just get the blood out and cure it. But it's done to follow some of these labs, and that's how we get helped. So what different imaging we do? There are a number of newer and not so new method of looking at bone. We do not usually do bone scan. That doesn't help in myeloma. And most of your oncologists at home would not do it either, because this is very well known. And every talk we give, either to the patients, but more importantly to the other oncologist, we emphasize don't do bone scan. It doesn't help in myeloma. We usually do the plain x-rays, but based on our and our colleagues' research, we are beginning to do more frequently MRI or PET scans. That helps us sometimes understand how the disease is, how well the treatment is working, where do we go from here. So you might hear about getting some of these scans more than in the past because we have a better understanding of this disease. So this is, for example, is MRI. Normally, the bone is like this, the dark color. In myeloma, it changes from black to white, and that tells us. So when we treat, we want it to go back to this kind of appearance. If there are nodules, etc., they should all disappear and become something like this. Similarly, we do PET scan. So in PET scan, you see this kind of dots. Each of these extra dot is myeloma lesion in the bone. This patient has a big lesion in the femur here. We might want to take a closer x-ray to see, is that bone likely to break or not. And then there are various settings where we do this, and this has become much more. Our most recent study that you will hear later on in the treatment and other algorithms has shown that this PET CT scan becoming normal may have good importance in how long our response will last. So we do that in a lot of different clinical settings. What's important is a change like this. This is before treatment, this is after treatment. All the dots have gone. And that's what we follow to see how well patients are doing. And also there are situations that we keep on bringing into our newer diagnostic criteria or changing the criteria. And this patient is a good example. Why do we do this MRI and PET CT scan? So this is a patient, young patient, he has clear evidence of myeloma because he has a M protein, he has bone marrow involvement, but nothing else. So he would fit into the criteria of the early disease, MGUS or smoldering myeloma. And we have an X-ray done, looks normal to the radiologist, to us. So looks like it's fine. But this patient got us MRI, and on MRI, we see a very big lesion. So few years ago, we would still call this patient a smoldering myeloma and wait and watch. Now with this better imaging and the newer criteria that we have just recently changed, he would get treatment. And the concept is this, that we don't want somebody to have a big bone lesion or a brick bone before we start treatment. That's not what we do in other cancer. That's not what we need to do in myeloma. We have drugs which are safe, drugs that work, so we can intervene more earlier. Second one is, for example, this is an older, relatively gentleman, 79-year-old, that for us, on myeloma side, is still on the young side. We can still do lots of treatment. Almost everything we have, we can utilize irrespective of the age. The reason I said older gentleman is because he has protein, myeloma protein. He has bone marrow involvement. But the rest of the features are normal. His kidney numbers were slightly abnormal, but not enough to be called myeloma. Now, we interpret the kidney number differently. And in the old days, which is literally 2 years ago, he would be smoldering myeloma and we wouldn't do anything. Now we know that this same kidney number, if it was in a 52-year-old gentleman, it might mean the kidneys are fine. But in somebody who is 79 or 80, that means the kidney is not good because the kidney functions changes with age. So this patient today, we would consider just starting treatment sooner. We don't want the kidney to fail. So there have been advances even in diagnosis of myeloma, which makes us intervene very differently. So we now look at how much bone marrow is involved when we diagnose somebody with smoldering myeloma. And if it's higher than 60, we would start treatment. We look at this serum free light chain, it's very high. That's another reason to start. And if we see these bone lesions by MRI or PET CT scan, then we may consider intervention. Now, these are general guidelines. Individual person would have different parameters that we or your outside physician may interpret differently and may not intervene, and which may still be quite appropriate. So I don't want you to take some of this literally, but this is the general guidelines that we follow. So we now include bone marrow, this free light chain, and MRI in our diagnosis of myeloma. So the second part is, how do we judge if the myeloma is what most of the patient would say, good myeloma or not so good myeloma? And again, these are the features that guide us. They are not absolute. We have all have many patients who would have features considered not good myeloma, and we have been seeing the patient for the last 10 or 12 years or more. So again, none of this applies to a given patient individually, but these are general direction that we follow. We look at all these prognostic criteria for various reasons. So one of the reasons is sometimes it helps us consider the treatment. So if your myeloma has features which tells us that maybe it could be more aggressive, we try to be more aggressive. If your myeloma doesn't have those features, we may not. We might give you treatment longer period of time. We might give you maintenance treatment, which is not just one drug, but two drugs. So there are modifications in treatment we can make based on what your prognostic features are. It also helps us plan on a longer term basis. We do transplant, we do maintenance, we're going to do X, Y, Z later on. We use some of the newer treatment that you will hear today. And that is sometimes based on this prognostic factor that we identify. It in some ways helps us prognosticate of the long-term outcome. Again, this is such a changing field, and that's where the excitement is, that what used to be called not so good myeloma, literally 2-3 years ago, it doesn't matter anymore. Chromosome 13, for example, and some of you may know, Jim would know, he is beyond the 13th time, but he passed through the 13th time. It used to be called a bad myeloma. We don't even do it anymore today because it is not a bad myeloma anymore. There's a 414 myeloma, which is almost going, not out yet, but almost there going out, because it used to be not called good myeloma. With Velcade and other similar drug, the responses and outcome is very similar, so we can overcome this. So all these features, we are able to have new drugs to overcome some of the high risk feature, etc. So we can plan and we can predict. And then, very importantly, it helps our research. We can find out why certain changes make myeloma more aggressive, and then we develop drugs to overcome that aggressive nature of myeloma, to overcome it. And starting from dexamethasone to the newest drug, they all achieve different things in way. Of course, as you heard about the effect of dexamethasone, it just doesn't affect myeloma, it affects the patient and the caregiver quite significantly. So we have a very simple staging system where we look at only two things, beta 2 microglobulin and albumin. We divide in what we call ISS stage 1, 2, 3, and we know one would have a little bit better outcome, three would have a chance of earlier relapse, and we try to modify the treatment. And you could see some, you will see some of these curves, which shows that the higher the curve, better prognosis, lower the curve, not so good prognosis. So if it's stage 3, ISS stage 3, we try and do something differently. The good news is that we don't talk about this whole lot when we see patients, because there are patients who are stage 3 still do very well with the newer drugs we have. So some of these are becoming less critically important because we are, but we are able to do it, but we still identify in our research. The second and the most important part is the genetic makeup of myeloma. It's quite chaotic. And that's not just myeloma. All cancers have this. Their genes are sort of messed up. We have 46 chromosomes in each of our cells. In myeloma, that number could be higher. Instead of pairs of two, sometimes there could be three. Having the same color, you could have this translocations and changes. And we have a tremendous amount of research ongoing to understand this, both what these changes are, as you will see in a minute, and how can we prevent some of these changes, which is the most exciting thing. That's what is going to make myeloma cells not change anymore, and that we can be more successful in treatment. You will hear about this FISH testing, and FISH testing is we do to identify some of these. The previous figure that I showed, the pretty-looking chromosome thing, we don't do that anymore. It's more difficult, expensive, and not necessary. The FISH testing, we look at number of dots, where are they positioned, and based on that, we identify what type of change your myeloma has. And this is where you will hear something called 414 translocation, 1416 translocation, 17p deletion, etc. This is how we identify it. And the importance of doing this is not only it tells us about prognosis, but we are beginning to have have treatments that maybe can be utilized. So patients who have 414 translocation, there's a figure here, somehow doesn't show up here, that tells us that myeloma cells are producing certain type of protein for which we have a specific drug. So doing this may also allow us to select drug to some extent in some of these patients. So these are the list, it's in your book, some of the features we consider higher risk, we keep in mind and follow them. Not all changes are bad. Some of these changes here are not high risk. They're there, but they're not causing myeloma to behave abnormally. And for that, we follow them, but not act on it. And to give an example of what I just mentioned previously, we are able to overcome some of this poor risk by drugs. So bortezomib is able to overcome this 414-related problem. Patients who have or doesn't have it, the curves have gone up, suggesting the patients with these changes, when they get bortezomib, they do better than what we used to do with the older drug. Same way when you take lenalidomide, some of these curves become flat here, suggesting that it's able to overcome the bad effects of these genomic changes. So all these newer drugs, when given by themselves or given in combination, a lot of you probably have gotten this combination of Revlimid, Velcade, and dexamethasone, and you will hear a lot about it from Paul in how effective it is. Paul put it together first many years ago in our first study that came out of Dana-Farber, and it's become standard of care all over the world, because the drug combination works 100% of the time. So when you see a patient, is the treatment going to work? It's going to be 100%. So that's because it's also able to overcome all these poor risk features in this disease. So for prognostication, we do this ISS staging system, we do this FISH, we look at specific translocation, and we are developing strategies on an ongoing basis to see how do we treat. We have all these new treatments you will hear, CAR T cells, immunotherapy, other newer targets and drugs. We're trying to see which one works best in which one of these subgroup of patients that we treat. So if you look at treatments, and which is what is important for our division of specific diagnosis, if somebody has MGUS, we just do close monitoring. There's no reason for observation as of now, maybe in future, but there's no need because very small number of patients ever develop myeloma in 30 years. Smoldering myeloma, little higher chance. Close observation is the mainstay, but if the risk is higher by our evaluation, then there are clinical studies, what myeloma drugs or vaccinations and immunotherapy strategies, and then we can treat if they have bone problem. And for myeloma, I'm going to skip it because we'll have the next 6 hours to hear about treatment of myeloma. And the final part is, what are we doing to improve this prognostication? And this is actually the most exciting time because we have the tools and we have the material to study it. There was a time when we could do all these things using large resources, which is still needed to do it, but it would take a long time. So if I needed to do sequencing, DNA sequencing, it would take almost 2 months and $10,000 to do one sequencing in a patient. Today, we can do this with $2,000 to $3,000, still extremely expensive when we are needing to study a large number of patients, but it's still feasible. And I can get results in 7 to 10 days, and we can analyze. So it's much faster, much better. And what has it gotten us? We are now beginning to understand this is better. So this is slightly older. You could see it is 2007. And 2007 in myeloma research is really old. It's almost getting outdated. So this gene expression profiling can identify three groups. There are 70 genes which drive this disease to some extent. And we can divide patients who have a higher chance of relapse versus lower chance of relapse, and we can use it in our treatment. In fact, this analysis now, and just to give an idea how 8 or 9 years matters in myeloma, none of us have done this in the last 3 to 4 years because we have newer, better things to do. So this is how the quick progress is, and that's where the hope and excitement is that we are going to fix this disease. So that particular study looks at one thing in the myeloma cells. We have many more things to do, and the reason we don't do it is because now we are able to look at together all these different changes. We look at the DNA, we look at the RNA, we look at what we call microRNA, we are beginning to look at protein and understand how the disease behaves. So these are my last few slides because this is where tomorrow is, and tomorrow never dies, right, Jim? So we find that there are lots of mutations in myeloma. On an average, there are 58 mutations. And this is, again, study done in 15. And you will see in a minute what is in 16 and 17 is even much beyond this because we do. So we do this, what we call exome sequencing. We find 58 genes to be mutated. And why is it important to find out this? Because we can now go after some of these genes to treat the patient, what one would call a personalized medicine. So we find these are the different genes. You don't need to remember this, although Paul is going to take an exam at the end and you'll have these questions. But some of these genes we have drugs for RAS, RAF, NRAS, and some of these genes we can use specific drugs to treat the patients. And so one patient, for example, was treated not too long ago, and the patient had this mutation called BRAF V600E. That's a specific mutation in this myeloma patient. And the drug that was used is a drug that is approved for melanoma. And melanoma patients have exactly the same mutation in their gene. So when this drug was used for myeloma patient now, not melanoma, and some people mix up both, a lot of people mix up both. This patient with one cycle had a very good response. Almost myeloma disappeared. So now, because we found this mutation in a patient, we can use this drug and treat this patient. And the lesion becomes small in within 28 days, all different things we look in the lab got better. So identifying such mutation can help us treatment. So we have a study that is about to start where we are going to use some of this mutation information to start treating patients based on that. And that study is almost about to open in a couple of weeks. look for mutation first. Of course, we need bone marrow. But we look for the mutation and then see if any of the drug we have are applicable. There will be around 30 to 40% patients who might have this mutation we can utilize. So this is very exciting. And finally, what we do today, we do this even bigger, more complicated analysis. So using the previous method, we could find 50 mutations in a patient. Using this newer method, we find 5,000 mutations in a patient because we can do much deeper analysis. This is 2016, almost going to 17. So even in 2 years, we have so much progress. What we are now trying to fix is that this patient, when he was diagnosed, had this many mutations. When patient got treated and relapsed, and this is, we save your bone marrow. So this patient bone marrow was saved before. And then when the myeloma came back, we did another bone marrow, saved the sample again, and we compared. So when the patient relapsed, that 5,000 mutation had gone up to 12,000 mutations. So myeloma cell keeps on changing, evolving. And that's the dual we have. If it is smart, we need to be smarter. If myeloma knows what to do to overcome what we do, we need to be smarter to overcome what it does. And that's what we are doing in the lab together, Ken and I, to see how can we stop this change, because that's going to be the key to ultimate success. And in that regards, each one of these dots is a mutation. So the drug that was used, the example I showed, that it targets this one dot. And a very intuitive question you will have and I will have is that when there are 12,000 dots making myeloma cell behave the way it does, is going after this one dot be enough? You know, the truth is yes, in this patient there was an effect. So it is helpful. However, we need to be a little bit more broader than just going after one dot in some patients. So it will work in some, but not in all. So what has this done? It has brought the immunotherapy back into very big prominence. So it tells us that we may have to use at some point combined all different targeted drugs in appropriate fashion. We have to develop mechanism that prevents myeloma from changing, cancer from changing, not just myeloma. But this is also the source of rise of immunotherapy. So some of the talk you will hear today will tell you how immunotherapy, let the body's immune system decide what dot to go after. We don't have to worry. The immune system is so powerful, and it will do the trick. So that's another hope that we have, excitement we have that we'll be doing. So I think I'll stop there. Oh, there's one more thing. And this is, again, coming from the lab, but something you're going to hear quite a lot. It's called measurement of minimal residual disease. When we treat myeloma and you are in complete remission, you have less than one cell in 100 in your bone marrow that may be myeloma. We can see it looks normal. It's a deceiving thing. But currently, looking at a microscope, we can't see it. But we have together, three of us and others, have developed this method and applied it to our patient called next-generation sequencing-based method. It's a sequencing PCR-based complicated method. I won't go into the detail because I think even though it's early in the day, a lot of people might fall asleep listening to that detail. But this method now can help us detect one myeloma cell in a million. So if it's hiding somewhere in the bone marrow, we can still find it. And using this method, now we can say which patient doesn't even have one myeloma cell in a million. And what we found that even though patients had achieved a complete remission, myeloma had gone by our traditional bone marrow examination, when we did this fancy testing, we found that those who were minimal residual disease negative, they didn't relapse much. But even though they were in complete remission, if they were not negative, they relapse much more frequently. So now, when we see patients get into good remission, we have access to this test that will tell us how to measure this. And then we are developing studies to see how to get patients into this MRD negativity. So another thing you will hear in literally moving this year and next year, that we would be measuring this in some patients. A study coming up where how, and Paul would describe that study, how would we get patients to MRD negativity. So I think tremendous progress. This is what you're going to hear today. That I think we are curing patients. We are just not saying it. And it'll become much more clearer as we go on in our research. And I must thank all of you for contributing. I think you are equal partner to what we do by giving yourselves and your samples and your stories that we can understand this thing. So thank you very much and happy to take questions.
Okay, so the first question we had is a yearly full body skeletal survey needed when a full body PT scan is also done in the same year?
That's an excellent question. So the answer is that there are some studies that still require the skeletal survey, some studies. On a regular basis, when we see patient off protocol, just a routine yearly skeletal survey is not necessary. Especially if PET CT is done or some other imaging is done, that's not usually necessary. I don't want to make a blanket statement because if your oncologist says you need it and he has reason for it, somebody has a pain that he wants to evaluate and not just do one X-ray but do more, that he may have some specific reason for him. But just routine basis, you are doing fine, you are in complete remission, there are no new symptoms. Neither of us routinely do X-rays as a standard practice.
Yeah. I think it's a very good question. And just to qualify that a little bit, we use skeletal survey still because it's very useful for assessing mineral bone loss. That's a very important point. We use routine skeletal survey to assess bone mineral loss because remember, bone densitometry, for example, is just done around the axial skeleton, the hip. But in fact, if you use skeletal survey, particularly with the better digital imaging now, you can assess mineral loss elsewhere. So, personally, I agree entirely with Nikhil that PET CT is the sort of new wave, but I'll often use both if I can. One of the challenges is that PET CT often will not be reimbursed, and that's a hard reality we have to deal with. So we try and juggle these things. And
yeah, so I think the financial aspects do come in picture. But if PET is done, then one has to judge if skeletal survey, how necessary, what the indications are.
And the next question was, can you please explain hyperviscosity as a symptom of myeloma? It was mentioned earlier in the presentation.
Yeah, so hyperviscosity is that myeloma produces protein, as I showed you. And when there is too much protein in blood, the blood becomes thick. And when the blood becomes thick, it doesn't flow well. And when the blood doesn't flow well, you get all sorts of symptoms. I won't go through all those symptoms because half of you will start getting those symptoms when I describe. But we know what to ask. All your doctors know what to ask. And judge it. In myeloma itself, the hyperviscosity is very less common. Waldenstrom macroglobulinemia is where we do see it much more often. It's only when protein is super high, and usually these days, that is very uncommon. So in myeloma, there's less concern, but everybody who treats myeloma is aware of it and would ask. So just by doing the blood test, if your IgG is 6 gram, I'm not worried about hyperviscosity. I might still ask questions that will tell us if there is any symptoms or not, but not routinely. It's only in Waldenstrom where it is a greater concern, and we sometimes sort of clean the blood to take care of it.